Giulio, buongiorno, ben arrivato.
Buongiorno.
La premessa è che Giulio farà
Buongiorno.
il talk in inglese.
Sì.
Si occupa di, vabbè, di device, soprattutto in questo momento gioca con iOS e è famoso per la sua collezione, ma questo è un altro paio di maniche. Ci parla di un uso inconvenzionale di un famoso exploit per un boot ROM, vero Giulio?
Esatto. Vuoi
Senti,
dire la
vai,
condivisione?
ti lascio la palla, presentati da solo, per tutto quello che ovviamente non ho detto in questi 5 secondi, the floor is yours.
Ok. Buongiorno a tutti. Ok, so I'll be introducing a quick project, a small project I made in the past few months. I am Zolfetti Giulio. I'm a technical project manager. I worked for several years as an Apple Devices hardware and software consultant. I worked also as a network system engineer for a couple of years. And now I'm exploring iOS internals in terms of both high level and low level point of views. The talk I'll be holding today is going to cover an unconventional use for a boot room exploit. So we're going to see what a boot room exploit is and how it is implemented, and what we can achieve with the use of such an exploit. So let's cover the iOS security model for a bit. We can see here the application processor boot chain. So this is the path that the CPU runs while turning on the device. On the first stage, we got secure ROM, which is the first piece of code executed by the iOS device. It's stored in a read-only memory, which is inside the CPU of the device. Then, in case we have to restore, it jumps to a remote send bootloader, which then loads the kernel and restore daemon. In the case we are normally turning on the device, we jump to the first stage bootloader, which is called iBoot, or in case of older devices, LLB, which is low-level bootloader, and iBoot itself again, which then hopefully loads iOS kernel, and which loads itself launch daemon. So here, Apple introduces a chain, what we call a chain of trust, which is called Secure Boot. As we can see, each component is programmed to check the image which is sent to it or which is loaded after it. And the sig check is performed at each stage. So due to the fact that the secure ROM resides in a read-only memory inside of CPU that cannot be changed and cannot be messed up with in any way, theoretically. Here's the format of the EMG4 standard, which is OpenSSL ASM.1. It consists of a payload, which is structured in the way that is shown on the left, and a manifest describing the payload, which is on the right. We cover a bit for some principles that rule the iOS activation and the device working in general. So we got system config. System config is a struct, a set of key value pair that holds the information describing the hardware of a specific unit. So, for example, serial number or motherboard number or wireless MAC address and Bluetooth MAC address are stored in this struct. As we can see, it's pretty complex and long, but we're going to cover just some keys of this database that are relevant for our scope. iOS activation is the process that leads the device to be from what we call the activation screen to get to the springboard, which is the home screen of the device. It's managed on the host side by lockdown daemon, which is lockdown D, which sends an activation token request to the server mentioned above, which is Albert server. The server validates the request and eventually sends a signed wildcard ticket for the lockdown D to activate the device. In the validation, system configuration entries are checked at this point. So, from a technical point of view, some components are linked to each other. So in case one of them fails and needs any kind of service, we have to figure out how to make this device work again with the new hardware or new features. Here's an iPhone 6 motherboard, and we're now covering the classic servicing procedure for the Wi-Fi integrated circuit, as taken as an example. So the process is made of five steps in the classic way. So we talk about removing the defective Wi-Fi integrated circuit, the one we have to remove because it's not working anymore. Since the wireless MAC address of the IC is contained in NAND, we now have to remove the NAND itself and edit the sysconfig data inside of NAND with the NAND IC programmer tool. Then we have to install back the NAND IC on the motherboard and install the new Wi-Fi IC once the sysconfiguration holds the new value. Here on the left, we can see the motherboard, and on the right, we can see the NAND IC. Here's the NAND IC programmer. It's nothing but a motherboard inside of a fancy fixture that holds a NAND interface, which is a socket for putting the target NAND interface. And then it has some debug and 10 volt meter. And it has, of course, a Lightning interface for USB and UART communication. Following the classic servicing procedure, I realized a video on how to perform a storage upgrade of an iDevice. I leave the link in the description. Anyone is interested, you can go check it out. It's pretty long, kind of almost 20 minutes. So given the fact that we have a secure chain of trust, we could potentially not attack secure boot anyway, unless we can find a bootroom bug, which allow us to use our code to run on the application processor. So this is the different approach we gotta cover. On the left, we can see SecureROM, and on the right, we can see the signed boot chain, which would normally take place if the device boots normally. We place the device into DFU mode, so we start the device at the first stage, which is running SecureROM, and he's waiting for an image to be sent, whether to restore the device in case of any damage to the file system, or in any other case in which the device is not able to boot itself in the normal way. We attack the SecureROM with the checkmate, which is nothing but a use after free bug in the SecureROM involving the USB stack. Not going to go deep with that. There's a pretty cool talk about Luca Tedesco, which is called the one weird trick that SecureROM hates. It's on YouTube. I suggest take a look at it if you're interested. And having the SecureROM attacked with checkmate leads us to control the application processor, and we can patch the signature checks and eventually boot any image we want. So we can edit an iBoot for the device. We're going to skip the signature checks on the first stage bootloader, which can be IBSS or IBSE for the old devices, or iBoot for the new devices. At this point, we can patch it to not check the following stage, which is gonna go to load our image that is called DIAGS. DIAGS is the system that is built inside the NAND programmers. So what we did here is to port the image running on the NAND programmer to the target iPhone or iPod or iPad itself. And this has the capability to edit system configuration. here is what the here's what the interface looks like. So for example, we're gonna cover that in a live demo in a bit. And here we can see that this interface, which is the user shell, can actually interact with system configuration and changing key and values, such as serial numbers shown below. And what's the point of all of this? We save time on NAND removal and installation, and avoiding risk of damaging the NAND itself by hardware working on it. We save money on hardware IC programmers. Those devices are really expensive. It can take up to $500 to buy one. And depends how new is it, what the features it are. But actually, we can take the same advantages by using the same image on the target itself rather than running it on an external hardware. And then we can cover a bit the theme that Weekend has possibilities. Dyax offers a set of tools that can be used for diagnostics, for example, I2C testing and other physical components testing as well. So we are conscious that not all the technician can achieve this scope. So all we wanted to do was implement an easy to use interface that automates all the process and delivers a one-click solution for the repair technicians that wanted to use this or couldn't ask for the NAND programmer. Here's a little demo of how it works. So the program waits for a device to be connected in DFU mode. Device is recognized on the USB interface of the Mac, and then once it's recognized, it sends the exploit. It sends the first stage, which is IBSS or iBoot. It waits for the first stage to load. It sends the second stage. When the first stage is ready, and then sends Dyax and jumps to it. So what we have later is an interface that is capable of interacting with the struct of system configuration. We have a lot of options that let us edit or remove or add values to this struct. We can the key pair, the key value pair is stored as a hexadecimal view. So here's listing all of them. For what it's worth, the activation of the iOS device, serial number, wireless MAC address, Bluetooth MAC address are binded together, as well as some other key values. So we have to restore them back in any situation that requires the device to go through the application to the iOS activation process again. So whether the device is freshly restored or whether the device is unable to boot and needs an update or upgrade or restore. Dyax offers a pretty long suite of tools that let us interact with the device from a both high level and low level point of view. As I mentioned before, we got E2C, where we can probe the device's listening on the E2C channel, and many other stuff that can really help isolating and troubleshooting any hardware problem on the device itself. Of course, a lot of people build fancy UI interfaces for this to be even easier to use for a technician. And those are available online, actually, for most of the NAND programmers. the fact that we reach the that we run the same image running on an NAND programmer give us the possibility to use the NAND programmer itself free tool to interact with it, and that becomes it. That makes my software, my application, a plug and play application which can be used from anyone with pretty much any device which is vulnerable to Checkmate. And that's it. I leave the links on my webpage and my Twitter profile where I post my devices in my collection and all my results of my research. So if you're interested, check it out. And thanks for your time.
Hai zippato la tua presentazione. Penso che sia andato sì. Molto molto di veloce. Esatto. Domande non ce ne sono. Okay. Dal pubblico. Hai qualche minuto se vuoi, vorrei evitare di farti domande io, ma se c'è qualche punto che pensi che meriti di essere approfondito un attimino, tornare sopra su qualche cosa, il tempo c'è, perché su alcuni punti si è andato effettivamente molto veloce.
Ok. So let's take the chance to do it manually. I mean, prepare the scene. We're gonna cover the manual path for loading DAIGs manually on a target device live. I'm sharing my first screen now. So, can you see my first screen?
Yeah. Not anymore. La regia ce l'ha tolto, però c'era. Eccolo, ci sei.
Okay, so in this moment, we're going to cover the manual procedure to put the DAIGs image to a target device. I'm connecting the D22, which is iPhone 10. I'm going to put it into DFU mode. Let me check. Okay, we're gonna keep this alive here. Now we got the device in the DFU mode. Are you seeing the screen, right? Okay. We are going to run the exploit and patch the signature checks. Okay, the device is now patched. Heap is repaired. We can boot unsigned firmware. we can enable the UART log so we can see what's happening behind the scenes. Now that the device is pwned with Checkmate, we can send iBoot for D22. Okay, see it's jumping into iBoot. Here we have the interactive shell of iBoot. The device is now technically in recovery mode, so it's waiting for another image to be sent. And then we send the DAGS image to it and tell them to jump to it. And we wait for the bootstrap. Okay, here we are. There we go. This is a manual procedure that is automated onto this application. Show it running glad. And going back to the FE mode, launch the binary. Here, it detected the device. And sending exploit, waiting first stage. First stage being sent, and the device is waiting to load it. Now, for some reason, he doesn't like the UR to be opened. Okay. Got some Python errors. Well, that's pretty much it. And yeah, I'll leave the slides of the presentation for anyone who wants to read further and watch the video I made.
Ok, grazie Giulio. Presentazione, devo dire, piuttosto verticale, piuttosto densa. Complimenti, molto molto interessante.